Okay, so we'll be starting off the drying portion. My stain isn't completely dry, but that's okay. I don't mind it being a little wet while I'm working. Kind of a basic drawing technique is using your brush as the measuring tool. One would be, I have a little marker here. I'm using this bottle as my marker, where I always want to be measuring from there. That way I keep the perspective and proportions correct from measuring from one fixed source. So I'm going to be going, let me just be making a mark on how tall this is. Now you don't have to transfer it right away into, from this angle, the cup will be kind of small. So all I really want to do is I'm going to get some more, just a little bit more of the thinner. And this would be kind of dark for you to be able to see it, hopefully. Say, I want my cup to be slightly off-center. Just makes it a little bit more interesting. We'll kind of fill up. That'll be the top. And we'll make this the bottom. I'm technically working wet into wet since the stain is still wet. This is something very common in plein air painting, which would be painting outside, street scenes or landscapes. But now, since I got the height, I'm just gonna measure. Let me see, comparing the height to the width. And from here, I see that from the widest part of the cup, of the mug, it's the same as the height. So if I'm measuring this way, you can make a line just down the middle if you like. But the height is the same size as the widest part of the mug. Now then, to get the opening of the cup. Maybe two-thirds the width. So two-thirds the width would be right here. From the very bottom, it's where my thumb is at. So be right there. So one thing we're doing is just get a little bit more thinner with the paint. And I'm just gonna draw it. It's important that your edges here, you can always refine this. This is just gonna be like a rough sketch in, is the corners of the mug right here. They're always rounded. We have a way of, the eye tricks you into wanting to make them have those points, but it's just a little unnatural. And I'm just gonna sketch in, really just rough it in. Rest of the coffee mug. Drawing from life has a way of making things a little nicer. Not that you can't use photographs, but painting from life really helps you with your hand-eye coordination. It allows you just to more of a natural look to it. So now we have like the handle the mug. You see me moving my hand. I'm really just trying to find the angle and also how high up it is. Because the cup is turning a bit, so what we're trying to do is get that same angle so it looks like what we're seeing. So if I measure the top of that handle and the bottom, and I'll just use the top as the standard tool of measurement. It's about halfway. So we have half right there. So I'll have to drop it. That looks about right. So I'll just make a mark there. Remeasure the angle, and the mark's already right there, the edge. We'll see how far out from the cup to the farthest point of that handle and measure it on the top again, and we'll see it's like about less than a fourth, a little bit more. That's the edge, so we'll make that mark right there. Just get a little bit more paint here. And there is, part of this can be a little tricky because it's not two-dimensional. It is a three-dimensional object. What's cool about painting is that you can just rough it in and refine it later. Just get the general shape in. And there's no rule saying that you can't go back and fix it. This is the easiest stage to fix things in. So one thing you can do is just make everything pretty square and just rough it in. Right there, that may look a little funny. A little straighter. Right there, it looks a little messy. But that's how it may look. We'll fix that when I put it in the background. So now, still using that same color and paint thinner, the color I was using is that Van Dyke brown. I'm just gonna touch on the darkest parts of the painting. Again, this is still considered the underpainting, which this would be just with Van Dyke brown and the paint thinner. This non-toxic paint thinner I like to use. So if I look at my mug and I squint, it just simplifies the object. It simplifies it, and I can see values a little better. I can see the edges and the darkest parts. So paint a little thicker, still using the thinner. And I see a dark shadow right about there. It's okay if that looks a little funny. We'll fix that with the overpainting. And I see one right there. Our shadow, our light source in this case is coming kind of at an angle this way. So if I was just our light source is that way. And just move this out just a little bit more. We can fix that. And our shadows. And maybe one more dark spot. There's not too much that's too dark. Be right inside the handle where it turns. Let me just get a little bit more paint. And squint at it, and I see it. I see that mark and one right there. Maybe just one more at it. See, right off the top would be on the top left of the mug. Right there. All right, so if I'm gonna use the same brush, I'll just dip it into a little mason jar with walnut oil. Just mix it around in there, take some of the oil out. In this kind of presentation, where it's kind of like a la prima, you don't really have to worry about the common rule that is spoken about, which is fat over lean. But say if we were gonna leave this stage how it is, we wanna let it dry thoroughly. And the next stage, when you do the overpainting, would say tomorrow or next week, instead of using paint thinner, you wanna use either paint straight out of the tube or add a little bit of oil to your paints. The reason why is because the thinner parts of paint dry a lot faster. And if you were to put wet paint or paint that dries faster on top of wet paint or semi semi-wet paint, you'll eventually, your oil painting will eventually lead to cracking, which if that's the desired effect, then go for it. If it's not, then you want to at least adhere to those rules. Is if you're going to use thinner, just straight thinner, it's only in the beginning of your painting. And if you're going to use thinner later, you always have to cut it with oil. In my case, if I have a glazing medium, I just measure out two parts thinner to one part walnut oil. And you can use that as a regular medium. There's a lot of mediums out in the market, but really, what you really just need for oil painting is just really just oil. So without letting this dry too much, we're gonna be, one thing I will do is I'm gonna put in a mark using my brush that I cleaned off, but still gonna be a little dirty. I'm gonna be using just a white with a little bit of ivory black. One thing about ivory black is that it is a really cold black. When you add white to it, and if you put it next to, let me pick up the palette. If you see it, it looks really kind of like in the blue, because that's not essentially what the black is, but it's so cold that if you put white and black next to a warm color, like this brown, it will appear a lot bluer. And this is very common in a Renaissance painting where blue is very expensive. And a lot of those paintings you see in the museums are often just white and ivory black. Something we'll touch on the next painting series or another thing is where I'm gonna introduce a Renaissance palette, or also known as a Zorn palette, which the only colors used for a Zorn palette is ivory black, titanium white, yellow ochre, and cad red light, or vermilion, French vermilion. But for right now, we're just gonna be doing a grisaille. But what I'm doing here is with that white, with a little bit, just a touch of that ivory black, I'm gonna punch in that highlight, which is just a little bit off the center point on the left-hand side, and I'm just gonna place it in there. If I was working on just a straight white canvas, you wouldn't be able really to see that highlight. But in this case, you can because I toned it. That's just one of the benefits of working on a toned canvas. I see a little mark right there, and I'm just gonna punch that in. And one more, kind of like right here on the lip of the mug. All right, so I'm gonna be switching brushes now. Let me clean that off really quickly, just rinse it. There's no rule on really how, like what kind of brush to use. I do recommend using, at least getting some rounds and flat brushes. For example, this is a flat brush. You can use it on a chiseled side or flat. And we have other brushes like a round brush. So I gotta restore the tip a bit. A round brush. And I recommend getting the sizes 0, 2, 4, 6, and 8. You don't really need that many. You can use any shape that you like. But for the background, what I'm gonna use right now is I'll just use a bristle. I'm gonna a filbert size 10 bristle brush. And what I'm gonna do is for the background, so I'm gonna dip in just with a little bit of my oil here. And in this little thing here, I'm just gonna get a little bit of oil. And what I have there is actually is this walnut alkyd medium. So it'll hopefully dry, if not by tomorrow, at least in the next day and a half or two. The reason why it's gonna take a little bit longer is because both titanium white and ivory black are slow drying colors. I'm gonna be using that. You just get some black here. You know, I may even put just a little bit of the thinner in there. The only reason why is because kind of traditional painting would be your darks are thinner than the lights. The lights would be painted more opaquely. Say, I'm gonna put that in there. I'm gonna put that in there. And like I mentioned, I like just quickly filling in, making it look like a sketch. I'm gonna grab a little bit more paint this time. Some more oil and paint. One thing that took me a while to get used to is not being afraid of using a lot of paint. Right now this is thin, but there's no rule as in we can always come back and work on this a little bit more. One thing I forgot to mention earlier is about the brushes, long handle versus short. This is a long handled one. Traditionally for oil painting, you want to be a little bit further away from your painting and your subject. The reason why is so that you can actually get a better look at your painting from further away. If you're very up close, you're not really seeing the whole painting as for what it is. And it can get kind of, not confusing, but it just helps aid your vision. So one thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna block in the cast shadow. And I won't load up the brush that much. Fortunately, the background on there has a lot of reflective light. So one thing I'll do is I'll just add a little bit of white there. Let me just pick up my palette so you can see. What I'm doing is I'm just a little bit of white and black, more of that gray. And I'm still working on the background. If I move over here, grab my value, so you'll see how it's closer to that second value. And here I'm using a 7 value range, which you can use just, or not just, you can use a 9 value range. One thing it helps from here is nothing in that background is as light as the cup. So I can just throw these in here. You can always work with this. With that a little bit better and just shaping. I want to shape that handle. Let me cut in there just a little bit more. There's a little bit of a reflective light that I see on the background right about here. So what I'll do is I'll just add a little bit more white. And see where I'm at. I can hold that up to the painting just to check value here. And that looks about right, maybe just a little bit darker. So I'm just gonna mix just a touch more black in there. I'm using a little bit less oil. Check it, and I'm gonna put it in. Then go back to the to this darker gray. Get a little bit of more oil. Fill this in right there. Nothing is darker than that cast shadow. So to refine that a bit, I'll get some more black. Get some more black here. Get a little bit more oil. And then paint that in one more time. So you're working wet and wet. You want to load up your brush a good amount. And you have, if you have just a little bit of more oil added to your paint, and gently move the brush over the wet paint, you'll get a nice soft transition, and it also keeps you from really moving the paint around and mixing it in an undesirable way. I'm just gonna punch those darks one more time a little bit more. It is darker in this area. Be a quick demonstration. Paint, not really concerned with that much. Just get rid of this over here. Okay, now we have pretty much the surrounding area of our subject, which is this coffee mug. Up. So, something clean that brush really quickly. Look at the subject. Yeah, I just missed a little spot with our darkest dark. So, with the same brush, I'm just gonna go back with that black. And I'm gonna refine that shape right here. All right, so just clean this one more time. I'm gonna move. I like working dark to light. It's like an old traditional, I guess, technique. You don't necessarily have to. It's whatever is easier for you, or a certain technique you're trying to do, or technique that you're using. Apologize. So one thing I'm going to do is I'm gonna take my values here. This is a stick I made, and I painted this on with acrylic paint. It does not necessarily perfect because acrylic dries darker than oils do, but I wanted it to dry faster. One of the things I'm going to hold up, it's kind of hard to see in this light, I'm going to see the darkest part of the cup. I'm just going to tilt this so that I can see a little better. So the darkest part looks like it's that second value, which is not as dark as just pure black. So I'm gonna get a little bit of that black. I'm gonna hold this up for the glare. Get a little bit more white. So if I look at the cup, I know it was this one. This value is a little bit lighter. And squint at the cup. I see that value there. I see it right here. I'm gonna leave a little bit of space right there because I do see reflective light. Put that in there. Put up the brush some more. that comes down just a little bit further. You see about the same value, maybe just a little bit darker. Right here on the lip of the cup. Maybe it's not as dark because the light is going in, so I'm gonna brighten it with white. I'm just gonna check that one. I'm not really adding any more. This is getting more on the lighter side. Just make this a little bit more opaque. I see it there, and I see a little bit of light there. Cool thing is with oils is since it dries a lot slower, you can still work with them while they're wet. Go back to the dark a little bit just to refine this bottom of the cup. We'll just be moving up the value scale. Using this is more like a fourth value. If I was to use, show you really quickly here. If I compare this, might be kind of hard to see, but if I see that, it's clearly a lot lighter than that black. If I move it up, I find it around the third and the fourth. I think just the fourth from the black. And all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna check it one more time, see where I can find this. See a little bit more. See different spots. Right now, I'm gonna be focusing mainly on the cup, and I'm just gonna kind of rough it in. Squint. This comes out a little bit more. Some over here. And a little bit on the top there. The way I like to paint is suggest things rather than putting them in there. This turns a little bit, so it should be slightly darker. One of the things I'm doing as well is I'm not pulling the paint very thinly. I'm letting it. I'm gonna blend two colors together. I'll use more paint. That way it doesn't just lose its intensity. Especially when you're starting out, you have a tendency of wanting to just load up the brush once or twice and then paint almost like the whole cup with just one load of the brush, but it's not necessarily, you can do that, but with the technique, it just doesn't, the paint is not gonna look as rich. One thing I did again is just checking value, constantly squinting at my cup here. So I do see a little bit light there. Isn't the lightest, so I'm just gonna block it in. Load it up again. See a little bit of a color there. A little bit more up higher on that side. And then it starts to turn. I'm trying to see where I see that value on the cup. So maybe just a little bit brighter, or lighter in value, I should say. This time I'm just gonna get a little bit of oil just to get the paint to flow a little bit better. Make sure you hold that. And check it, I see a light there, and a light there. Load it up some more. load up the brush with paint, put it right there. So one thing you'll see if you look at the cup is there is reflective light in this area. So I can just punch that just a little bit so you can see it, and then work that in there. The cool thing is with this is that you can, with oils, is that you can work them wet into wet. So one thing you can do is here is essentially what I'm doing is just blocking in almost the whole cup. Is that part that we're looking at there. And I'll show you what I can do there to get some of the lights, but I do see some darks. So I'm just gonna darken up the value here, a little bit of black. Looks about right, maybe right there where the cup does turn. Using those darks again, do I see them anywhere else? It might be a little too dark there by the highlight. I think I just got a little bit of lighter paint and I'm gonna gently put it up there, that's better. A little bit of darker. Move it right up. So, a little bit of a lighter note, or lighter note, sorry. It's a lighter tone, right? About here, almost kind of reflecting that highlight, and it drops down a bit. And then into a darker tone right on the bottom there. My squint, just block that in. I'm gonna always lighten it, and actually mainly want to just darken. When you're painting, you can always darken it. It's harder to lighten the painting. If I wanted the background to be lighter, I'd have to either wait for that to dry or rub off the paint with a rag or with a palette knife and work it some more. Another technique, if you don't mind like a messy look, is just getting some of this gray and mixing it in with that black. It will darken, but it will also lighten it as well. Let's go just a little bit on the lighter. Lighter side there. We're gonna see where this fits in on our value scale to the number 2. You can try to find it. This is definitely one right there. Load up the brush, put that in, load it up again. There's some right above the highlight. I'm gonna follow the highlight on the bottom. And there's some lights right here. I see some light coming down here as well. Bigger shape of a light tone right there. So this isn't as dramatic as a lot of other paintings. I do mean the black does give the dramatic feel. But there isn't an intense shadow on this side of the cup or the mug. This is also a good exercise for me. I haven't done a grisaille study in a bit. Darken this a bit. You see the forms start to take place. Load it up with more paint, a little bit darker value here. That's what I'm seeing. One thing I see in that area is reflected light. It's not as dark, or it's not as light as these over here, but it is significantly lighter, and especially to that part right there. So I'm gonna just, I was really just guessing. Put it in. Too similar to that value, so I'm just gonna add a little bit of white and punch that in. Reflective light is actually stronger there. I did miss a little bit of dark. That's a little too dark. I'm just gonna punch those in. And mind you, this is still with the same brush. I'll just clean it when I have to. And I stop. There, and it is a bit of a shadow there. That needs to be a little bit darker right there. So I'm just gonna focus on finishing the inside of the cup there. Lighter, get closer to the highlight, but not too bright. One thing that's important to note is that the lines are invented, kind of, or not really invented, but our mind wants to see lines because lines don't exist in nature. They're just values and color. So you can start off as you're painting with lines, just to kind of call it a contour drawing, and then move on into your value study where you'll see it really come to life here. So get on the handle really quickly. There is a dark. I'm going back to the darks here. Getting a good amount of black. It's not completely black, but that's a good one. I'm gonna get a little bit of oil, help it dry, but also get it to flow better. And I see a little bit of a shadow just in here. So I'm just gonna drop it in there. And same thing on this, where it turns, drop it in there. And there is some reflective light. So I'm getting a little bit of a brighter, lighter gray. And I'm gonna punch it in right up here. It'll be a little too bright, but that's okay. Then we're gonna go into the lights, clean the brush one more time, and I'm probably gonna switch to a smaller one in that area. Usually a good thing to start with is a big brush where you block everything in, and if you're doing details, you move to a smaller one. So I will be using, I'm gonna stick with a filbert bristle brush to get these areas right here, and then I guess we'll move on into a little bit of blending. Let's go with the light here. It's not too light in that area because it is mainly in shadow. I'm just gonna see where I'm at. Punch that in there. Maybe just a little bit darker. Do a little bit more black. So next to this cool, like I was speaking about earlier, next to this cool black on the background, these look grayer, but if it was to stay brown, they'll look more on the blue, as a blue cup or a blue hue to it. Let me just check that, just throw that in there. Just a little bit right there. Light and a shadow on that side. A little bit lighter. Just mess with this. That highlight gets a little bit more light in that area. So we can just punch this in right here. Then we're gonna look at this a little bit more closely. It gets a little tricky in this area because you have the highlight. What helps if you squint, because the surrounding area is a little bit darker. And it does have some lights in there, because it does catch the light. Again, I'm just gonna punch really quickly and punch in some of the lighter tones again. This is with kind of a thick paint. I didn't use any additional walnut oil. I didn't use any walnut oil really for the lighter tones. But there is reflective light there. Just gonna put it in. So the lightest part are the highlights, so it's important to just keep that in mind. And also if you see that you made one part brighter than the other, you can just go in there and correct it. And correct that highlight as well as this. That was all of them, why not? There's a light up here. And just really soft. And I wipe off the brush, my rag here, or my apron, and then clean that really quickly. I'm gonna put in the highlight one more time. So it's not pure white, but it is a pretty bright one. Right in there, get a little bit more, and it's a really thin one right there. See any other highlight? No, but I do see other places where we can punch in some more lights. Paint here. It's important that those edges are soft. Reason why, if you see anything in real life, nothing really has a hard edge or a sharp edge. But this is a painting, so you can do whatever you'd like. You see a soft edge, by all means put it in there, or a hard edge. One thing I see, I didn't do that right, is on the left side here, I could could be a little bit better. This would be a quick demonstration. It's a little bit darker, so we're just gonna put a little bit of walnut oil and gonna work that in there. I'm just gonna redefine this shape over here. And there is a little bit of a darker tone between the reflective light here and the rest of the cup. See how it goes up there, this kind of drops down. Quickly, there's a darker tone there. Okay, one thing I'll do again is a little bit of a thicker paint. I'll redefine the mug using the background color and a flat, synthetic, soft, it's pretty soft brush here. I'm gonna load up my brush with a lot of paint. And some walnut oil, dip in there. And where I see, not a sharp edge, but it is darker there. There, that edge is soft. And the cast shadow actually comes up a little higher and cuts into the cup. Cover up the rest of your canvas, at least with this demonstration, the rest. I made that cast shadow really get lost with the background in this area. That's okay, that's what I'm going for. There's reflective light there. Back a little bit. So one thing I will do is talk about a little bit of blending. Now blending has different techniques to blending. One thing I'll just show right now is like a dry brush blending. Let me just rinse my brush there with some walnut oil, clean it off. And I'll use another soft flat brush. This is also synthetic. Put my palette down. One thing you can do is some of the edges that look really kind of rough, if you like them like that, that's fine. There's only one edge I see that I kind of really want to fix is this edge right here with the reflective light and the dark background. So one thing I'll do is I'm gonna load up my brush, not really dry brush anymore since I just loaded it with paint, but I'm gonna put that in there. And then with that same brush, I'm gonna mix a little bit of that black. And I didn't really clean the brush. And right when that reflective light meets that background, I squint it, it's really soft. Should probably get a thinner brush for that. I'm gonna use the brush I'll use to do that would be this synthetic round brush. I'm gonna restore the tip on there really quickly, but I'll show that when we're at the cleanup session. And I get the little bit of that value between those two, that light and that dark, and then just soften it that way. Load it up with a little bit more paint. And then one other one I see is this. This looks really sharp here. Let's just soften that. I don't see a sharpness there. Here. Get a little bit more dark paint there and reshape that. Take it steady really quickly. What I can do is getting more black paint, thinning it down with a little bit more oil. This line. Get a little bit of a shadow underneath. And that shadow gets lost. So I usually don't like to blend that much, but for this demonstration I will. Let me grab another brush. This is a clean, really soft. This is also a has a little bit of oil on there, but a soft synthetic brush. And I don't really want to mix, everything. I don't want everything to be really soft, but just certain transitions. You can just soften by just lightly and clean off the brush and just lightly work on the transition that you want to soften. This one right here. And that will be it. That would be the finished grisaille study of a still life. This is a coffee mug. I'll just leave it like that. Blending is something can be kind of personal. If you look at other painters, like I'm not comparing myself to John Singer Sargent, but John Singer Sargent knew or worked his brush actually fairly loosely. And up close, this may not look to people like a completed painting, which is just a study. But if you take a step back and you were to look at your painting and then look at the object, trying to get the same perspective, it'll actually will come to life more. And that will be the end of this demonstration. In the next segment of painting, we'll introduce color. I'll be talking about the Zorn palette or Renaissance palette, which consists of ivory black, cad red light or cadmium red light, or if you have vermilion, that works as well. Yellow ochre and titanium white. Thank you, I hope you found this useful, and you can do some more grisaille studies. Those are really important for you to as an artist or painter to really be able to see value. So you can use an object like a coffee mug, more advanced if you're doing portraiture or portraits, then a model would be very handy, or anything really, flowers, but just try to do as many grisailles, black and white paintings or brown and white paintings as possible. That'll help you see light and shadow, and also helps you with your drawing technique.